you feel most comfortable. But do something that outstretches yourself today to worship Him. We are free in Him. Amen. Oh my word. Are we free in Him? Amen. Thank you, Lord God. Let's worship Him. Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me.
Yeah.
child of God. Yes, I am.
Amen. How many can say you're glad that you're a child of God today? Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's just invite His presence here today as we go into this service. Put aside any distractions, anything you've been through this week. Give them to Jesus today. And just let Jesus do His work in your life today. And let's expect as we've gathered together in this place, others are on their way yet. Let's just expect today that God's going to move in this place in such a mighty way. Let's give God all the glory today. Amen. Let's just praise Him and worship Him and declare His blessings in this place and declare who He is and what He's about. And so, Father God, we come before You today. We're so thankful for the things that You do in our lives each and every moment. We thank You that You never leave us, You never forsake us, but You're always with us. I pray today for this service, God. I ask, Lord, Holy Spirit, that You would just show up in such a mighty way. God, we don't want to just hold a service on a Sunday morning because, well, that's what people do. We want to come together today. We want to experience Your presence today. We want to know Your goodness in this place today, Jesus. We want to sing songs and declare with our voices who You are and what You have done and praise You and magnify Your name today. We want to, God, just worship You in this place. We want to fall to our knees and just honor You, God, with the praises of our hearts today, Lord. And so, God, be lifted up in what You hear today. Be lifted up in what takes place in this room today, God. Be lifted up by the praises of Your people today, Jesus. Lord, we just want to give You the freedom today in the room, in this place, to move in our lives, God. We all need You, God. We all need something from Your presence, from Your power today. We all need something from Your word today. And so, God, we've come with expectation in our hearts to declare that You are going to move in this place, Lord. Father, heal those that are sick today, God. Father, move in the situations and the circumstances of those who need it today, Lord. But Father, let us just magnify Your name, God. Let us just worship You together. And Holy Spirit, just do something great to unite our hearts as one. Because that's where You move, when Your people come together as one. And so we ask, God, that it would be that atmosphere today as we just make this place, God, a place where You can move and where You can speak and where You can do what You want to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now you can come up front if you'd like to worship. You want to stay where you're at, that's fine too. But let's praise Him today. Let's declare who our God is. Amen. And let's give Him all the glory. Hallelujah.
He has a beautiful name, the name of Jesus.
What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus.
are the beautiful name, Father Lord. You came, Father Lord. You came for us, Lord Jesus. We worship you, Father Lord God. Nothing could hold you back.
Death could not hold you. They'll come before you. Silence the powers of sin and praise. Heavens are roaring. Praise of your glory. For you are raised to life above.
Hallelujah. You have no rival.
You have no rival. You have no equal.
Trust is, Father Lord. We know, Father Lord, what you've done, Father Lord. Greater things are yet to be done, Father Lord God. Lord, we worship you, Father Lord. We praise you, Father Lord. It is that powerful name of Jesus that tears down every stronghold in Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord God. We raise a hallelujah to you today, Father Lord God. We raise a hallelujah. Our highest praise, Father, is to raise a hallelujah, Lord God. We sing it within our being, Father, today.
I'm gonna sing.
blessing, Father, Lord God, because we know no matter what the storm is, Lord, we know where our trust is. We know where we put our trust in today, and it's in you, Father, Lord. So we're going to sing a little louder. Hallelujah, Jesus. Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Raising a hallelujah, we're talking about praising Jesus, amen. We're talking about giving him the glory. There's times, folks, let's be honest. There's times when we go through life and we just don't feel like raising a hallelujah. There are times when we don't understand the things that are coming against us. There are times when we don't understand the emotions that we're having. We don't understand the things that the enemy's attacking us with. But those are the best times to raise the hallelujah. Those are the times to look to Jesus. Those are the best times to try to focus in on him and to see what he is doing in the midst of that. And we've all been through those times. We've all experienced those times. The sad part is the enemy makes us think, well, nobody's experienced like you've experienced it. And nobody's being tempted like you're being tempted. Or nobody's going through this like you're going through this. And the Bible's very quick to dispel that lie by saying, no, we've all been tempted with the same things. We've all experienced the same hurts. Maybe to different degrees because of the different things that were related to that. But we've all experienced those things. And we're here as a small body of Christ today. We're here as a testimony to what Jesus has done. Amen. We're here today because somehow God got us through that. We're here today because somehow in his marvelous power, in his presence, God was able to walk us through those things. Maybe God placed a brother or a sister in our life that just knocked us across the head and said, come on, God hasn't given up on you.
That's right.
Maybe God used somebody that prayed for us and we didn't even know they were praying for us, but they were praying us through those situations. Maybe we'll never know this side of heaven what God did and who God used to get us to where we're at today. But aren't we thankful that he has? Amen. Aren't we thankful that he's put people in our lives? Aren't we thankful that he's put people to pray for us and to knock us across the head once in a while and say, come on, brother. Come on, sister. Aren't we glad for those times? God says he would never leave us. He would never forsake us. Today, if you're in those places today, I'm going to call the prayer team forward today, those that are here. And if you need prayer for something, anything today, let us pray with you. Let us agree with you today. Let us believe for you in those things today. Don't sit there. Don't say, well, you know, somebody else is going through it worse than me, or well, I've got it worse than, you know. No, no, no. Listen, God's here to meet you today in this place. God's here to make a difference in your life today. Let's let him do that. Amen. Let's carve the room out. Let's carve the space out for that to happen. Those of you that will stay at your seats, sing the song with us, but also put something into it. Put something, you know, whether you want to raise your hands toward that person or not that we're praying for, that's fine. But raise your faith towards them today. Believe with them today. You may not know what they're going through. You may not know the situation. God may begin to break your heart for somebody who comes up today. Who knows what God's going to do? But let's lend ourselves to the healing here. Let's lend ourselves to the move of God's Spirit here. Let's put ourselves into a place today where we can create an attitude where God moves. I want to tell you, if you've ever been to a healing service, Brother Benny Hinn or some of these other men and women who move in healing, it's an electrically charged place. It's a place where the people's spirits are lifted, where there's a faith that's rising, and we can do that today. It's not that we want to manipulate something or make something happen, but we can lend ourselves to an environment today where people's lives are touched and where people's lives are made whole. But we have to do that. We have to step into it. God doesn't do that in us. We have to walk forward. Amen. And so let's believe for that today as these ones come forward. Mm-hmm. And let's give God the glory for what he's about to do. Amen.
Amen. We need him today. Lord, I come, I confess, thou art here. I find my rest without. sin runs deep.
Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Teach my song to rise to you.
Attitude of prayer, Eileen and Barry reminded me, we had a young girl who attended our church many years ago, Jessica. Some of you have already been praying for her. It's Ron and Joanne's, it's Joanne's daughter, Ron's stepdaughter, and she's in great need. She's had an infection from a surgery that she had years ago. An infection has set in to her back. In the midst of that, Eileen just told me that there's even a stroke today that took place, and she's got to be somewhere between my oldest and my youngest, probably 26, 27, somewhere in there. How old? 30. Okay, she's older than my oldest then. I didn't realize that. And so we just want to pray for her. She's been in a battle for the last few months, and she's been, I know that there are a ton of people because of Ron and Joanne going to different churches and things like that. There's a group of people that have just lifted her up in prayer, but it just seems that every time something good looks like it's happening, something bad takes place. So we want to pray for her today. Her name is Jessica. Would you just pray with me today and just believe that God would move in her life? Father, we lift up Jessie to you, God, and we ask today that you would move in her midst, Father. Lord, one thing I know in living in this life is I don't know why, God. I don't have the answers to everything, God. You hold those answers. But I do know that we live in a broken world. And because we live in a broken world, a world that is full of sin and rebelliousness, that there are disease and there is sicknesses and there is death. It's not the life that you created for us to live, but it's the life that we created for us by our rebelliousness against you. In this world, God, things will attack us. In this world, the enemy will bring things against us. And many times he does that to stunt or to hinder your plan for our lives. And Father, I believe that that's what's going on with Jessica today, God. I believe that she's a godly woman. She knows you, God. And in the midst of that, God, there's something that you have called her to, Lord. And the enemy is severely attacking that, Lord. And first, we speak life, Lord. There will be no death. There will be, we speak life, God. And we command that she would live. And that she would not live in a way that is hindered, but in a way that is blessed and in a way that is fulfilled. And so, God, we ask that your plan for her life would come to fruition, Father. Yes. We ask, God, that this infection, as I've already prayed, Father, with Barry and Eileen, that this infection would be dried up at its root, that it would be killed, that it would be dealt with, that it would not have the effect in the body that it's been having, Lord. We pray for her amidst this stroke today, this whatever it is, this mini stroke or whatever it is that she's faced today, God, and ask, God, that you would just be with her, Lord. Take the pain, Father, Lord, and Father, let your healing power flow through her body today, God. Raise her up off the bed of affliction, off the bed of sickness, off the bed of disease today, God. And Father, let her know life, Lord. Father, we ask that you would do this as many churches are praying, as many Christians are lifting her up, as many people of faith are saying, God, heal Jessica, God. We just add our voice into that today and ask that it would be done, Lord, according to your glory, Father. And that you would be glorified and that there'd be a great testimony on the other side of this, Lord. That, Father, Lord, you would be known. Hallelujah. We just commit her into your hands this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. You may be seated. Thank you. Ushers are coming forward to receive this morning's tithes and offerings. It's the second week of the month, so our second, we're doing that at the end. Thanks. It's the second Sunday today, so our second offering will be for benevolence. We have a benevolence fund here at the church that we help people in the community with different things, get back on their feet and food and those types of things and shelter and all those things. So that's what the second offering's for. You can put it in the first offering if you like, just mark it on the envelope. Where what amount goes to which, and we can make sure that gets designated and put into the proper funds. Amen. So stand with me today, and let's just declare God's blessing over this and God's multiplication over this. Jesus, we honor you. Father God, we honor you, your word that says bring the tithes and the offerings into the storehouse. Jesus said don't forget the alms. And today we bring our alms. We bring our benevolence offering. We bring that for the ones who need it, God. We pray, God, that this would be blessed. We pray, God, that it would be multiplied. We ask, God, that you would use it for your glory, not just for this building and for this people, God, but, God, for the people that are driving by right now, for the people who live in a certain mileage around us, God, for the people who live in the townships and in the cities and the areas where people who are attending today come from, God, that, Lord, you would extend our effect. You would extend the touch of your community through this church because of where our people come from, Lord. We ask, God, that we would always have enough and more, God, to do what you have called us to do. We ask, God, that you would always, Lord, continue to move in our midst and use us for your glory, Father. And we release this into your hand today, God. And we call it blessed and not cursed, God. We call it abundant and not deficient, God. And, Lord, we just thank you for all that you are done and what you are doing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. Let's take that today. Children, stay up because we're going to do awards today. So children are staying up today.
I was lost with a broken heart. Can we
sing this today. Come on and stand. Let's sing this.
In the midst of the darkest night, let your love be the shining light. Break the chains that were holding me. You sent your son down and set me free. Everything of this world will fade. I'm pressing on till I see your face.
I will live that your will be done. I won't stop till the kingdom comes. You are my freedom. We lift you higher. We lift you higher. Your love, never ending. Oh,
come on.
You are alive in us. Nothing can take your place. You are all we need. Your love has.
You are alive.
You are alive in us. Nothing can take your place. You are all we need. Your love has set us free.
Leading today. Thank you for playing your instruments and singing those with those voices. You may be seated today. We always make something of our worship here because we believe that God is involved in our lives. And in just a moment, we're going to turn it over to Kim because we're giving out our awards for Awana. But I want to introduce you to somebody today because as I think of Awana and his children, this woman could not be overlooked. And I know she's going to be very mad at me, and that's okay. But Marie Nye, you need to stand, sister. She said they won't know I'm standing. Marie Nye, I don't even know how many years you served in the children's church here, and in the 20 years in the children's church here, and in our. And she changed young people's lives. She changed kids' lives for. They're adults now. My son Kenny always talks about her and.
He was here the last time he preached, he spoke about you.
Yes.
So.
Amen. So it's so good to see you. And I'll tell you what, I didn't know she wanted to attend here, but she told me today she doesn't get here because she can't drive. We could get somebody to pick her up if she wants to be here. I know that. She's not far away. But I can tell you what, if you ever get to sit with her and let her tell you the stories about how God just provided for her as a single mom. It is the most amazing thing. I'll never forget a story she told me that, I hope I have this right because it was years and years ago you told me, that her refrigerator and freezer went, and she didn't know what she was going to do. She didn't have the money for it. And she's a working lady. She always worked. Mm-hmm. And she just prayed. She gave it in God's hands. And a truck pulled up in her front yard. To this day, she had no idea how it ever happened, and they had a refrigerator and freezer for her that had her name on it. And that's the blessing of the Lord. I mean,
Amen.
She never told anybody, just told Jesus. And who knows whether they dropped it off at the wrong place or not, but it was the right place. Amen. It was hers. It was God's blessing to her. And boy, if you ever get to just sit with her and get to talk with her, just praise God. Always in prayer meetings here, always in everything that took place that kept this church going, Marie and I was involved in. And just thanks for being here. Really love
That's
you,
awesome.
Sister. Amen. And so with that being said, we're going to give our awards out to our children. We're going to rejoice with the work that they've done and are continuing to do and honor them today because these kids have worked hard.
Yes, they
so
have.
So I'll turn it over to Miss Kimmy.
They have been working hard the last 2 months. We haven't been able to do awards because of the holiday. But as you know, we have Awana, so we do different levels. We do Puggles, Cubbies, Sparks, and TNT. So we start all the way with the little guys. We go all the way to preschool. And my little preschooler, if I can have Miss Taisha up. Taisha is my leader. Miss Ty. In fact, Ty, I didn't get to tell you. You need to sign her award here. But we have our youngest one this year is our Puggles, which is Miss Ella. Are you coming up, Miss Ella? Do you want your award? She is a riot. I got to teach her last week because Ty was not able to come. She is a riot. She's a cutie. Come on, go get your award. She learned about creation. She's been learning about the 7 days and how God created the earth. And then on the 7th day, he rested. So she gets her award for learning the days of seven. You can sit back down. It's fine, unless you want help. So that's our little puggle. Good job, Miss Ella. And they have to learn a little verse that goes with it. It's only a couple of words, but they're still learning the Word of God at that age. They can learn. Our next group is Cubbies. Miss Tiff. Tiff does our Cubby group. And I don't see Rachel here, but I guess they're not here today. But we also have Emmy and Cole. Where's our Cole and Emmy at? Miss Emmy. Cole has his vest on. You got to take the little tab off, the white off. They earned their green apple. They learned about creation also. And they've been learning about the day of rest. And what else? Did I miss one? It fell off, probably. Fashion statement. See me afterwards because they had one of the red ones came off. Okay. We'll have to get them. For some reason, the stickies, they're only sticky. They don't all stick sometimes. And they play downstairs, so sometimes they lose them. And they do pick them off, too, yes. So they're our little guys. They're up to our kindergarten. They did a really good job. They've been learning. And again, they have verses that they have to give to Miss Tiff. And then the week after, Tiffany actually quizzes them again to make sure they learn the verse. Then we have Daniel, I don't see Daniel, and Aileen. Where's Miss Aileen? And you know what? Let me get all my Sparks leader ups here because we have several through the next group. Our Sparks is kindergarten, first and second, third, we sort of sway around with. And we have several leaders because we divide the kids up and we try to keep them in smaller groups. It's hard, especially when you have two kids that are on different verses or they're learning the books of the Bible or whatever. So there's some of them that have two. Miss Lucy usually has two, and Tony sometimes has two, and then you have just Finn and you have Aileen too. So it's very hard when you have more than one student on different things, but they do an awesome job, and I thank them for it. They come out every week. And Aileen is getting her Red Jewel 1. She learned 5 verses. So it goes from the top down. She learned 5 verses. She learned God talks to us through the Bible. She learned John 20:31. She learned Psalms 118:1-4. And another one she learned was John 4:19. And she did really good. And she also is getting her green jewel on top of it. She's getting her green jewel for another 5 verses. Some of the verses that she learned was Psalm 118:1-2. She learned Genesis, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. And he saw that it was good. Genesis 1:31, and she also learned Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So they did an awesome job learning. Daniel's not here. We'll give him his on Wednesday night. Jason is Green Jewel 3. Where's Jason at? He's up there already. They're all up here. Green Jewel 3. He had a hard one. The way that they break them down to learn the books of the Bible, He gets two different jewels. He's getting his green jewel now for completing everything, but they divide him up in little sections first. So he learned the seven books from Ecclesiastes to Daniel. Then he had to recite Hosea to Nahum. Then he had to recite Habakkuk to Malachi. And then when he was done with all that, he had to say all the books of the Old Testament straight through. They're only allowed two helps through those sections. So he, with two helps, he did an awesome job. So good job, Jason. Bryce is not here. He did also the whole Old Testament. Ethan. Hi, Ethan. I'm so glad you made it today. Sometimes we have to give Ethan's downstairs. I'm so glad he made it. He had to do his missionary activity. He's getting Red Jewel 3. He gets Red Jewel 3. He had to do Genesis 1, John 17:17, 1 Peter 1:25, John 14:6 are some of the ones. And he's also getting Green Jewel 3 for four verses. I know you don't realize how painstaking these are to get in because they're so tiny. There is a little tool that we try to use, and sometimes it works, and sometimes it doesn't work. So he also had to learn Colossians 1:3. He had to learn how many books are in the New Testament. He had to learn 2 Corinthians He had to learn the New Testament books, and they divide them up into different sections, and he learned all them. Then he had to do John 13:14 and John 13:15. So he worked really hard on his. Yeah, he gets a red and a green. Mm-hmm. Finn is not here today. Finn actually finished his whole second book. Finn is a visitor that he just comes to our Awana. He did a really good job. He's finishing his book, so we were going to give him his award, and actually this is what they'll get when they finish the second book. They get a nice ribbon. So he's going to be getting that. We'll give that on Wednesday night. And then I have Miss Maya. Miss Maya is the only one that got church attendance. And there. How many liters does it take to put a red jewel on a child? Oh, green jewel. Mom can do it. And then Miss Lucy does Miss Maya. Miss Maya is working on her last book now. She's going to be getting, if all goes well and she finishes her third book, she's actually going to be, I think, the only one that has ever gotten a plaque. So, and then right behind her is Jason. Jason might be getting his third too, once he's getting there too. So we might be giving out some plaques this year. It's going to be really good. So she'll be our first girl and we'll have our first boy. So I am so excited for them. You guys did an awesome job. Yay! And thank you, leaders. You can go sit down, thanks. I'm gonna do TNT. And he's not here. Lorenzo wasn't having it today. Blue's different. Blue is attendance. Tone, you went out, but I need somebody to do for Miss L. Since Tom's not here. Tom usually does our wonderful only TNT right now, our Miss Lily. And Tom put on her paper. You rocked it, girl. So she is getting, these are hard verses. She just doesn't have one verse. She has like two and three four at a shot. So she worked really hard. She had to do four at a time. So she's learned Genesis 12, 1 and 2. She learned the Old Testament. She learned Proverbs 1, 7. She did 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4. She did Revelation 1, 1 and 2. Acts 13, 48 to 49. And 2 Thessalonians 2, 15. She had 8 verses total she had to do. And she's getting her Discovery Emblem silver and gold to add on. So good job, Miss Lowe. We're proud of you. She helps out. She's a really good helper too downstairs. So, kids, you are dismissed. I have a little one up here, an extra little one.
You're dismissed. Go downstairs. Have a great day. We love you. And hey, I want you to know the parents have not forgot to take their clothes tags off. That's the code that they have. We put it on the back of their shirts so that they can't pull them off. So that's the code, the security code that the parents need when they go to pick them up. So. And Ethan, I don't know, when I grow up, I want to have hair like Ethan does. That's a gray head of hair right there that kid's got, man. That's all I got to say. Rock it, Ethan, rock it. I hope you have it longer than I did. Let's go over some announcements today as we're clearing out and getting things set up as we get into the Word. Dave, roll both of those videos. I finally got the OSL video right today, I think. So we'll just roll both of them right after the other. This is our Wednesday night Bible study, the book of 1 Corinthians.
This was the hub of intellect, the hub of knowledge. There were so many other gods, there were so many other things to love in this culture. This is where the most enlightened people were, and Paul shows up with an entirely different new faith. The church of the time wasn't dealing with their sin. They were worshiping other idols. They looked just like the world around them. We don't look out at a society that's broken, that's sinful, that's desolate of the gospel, and approach it with hate and fear. We approach it with the power of God, full of hope and full of love. But if we sit here with our hands folded in fear at what's happening online or in the news or in our neighborhoods or in our families or in our churches, then we are going to be leaning on our own wisdom and what we see instead of trusting in the power of God. Paul says, there's one thing that is going to be what my life is about, and that thing is to preach the gospel. It's not going to be in our effort, our power, our wisdom. It's going to only be the Spirit of God moving through us. He's not looking for the most qualified, the most polished, the most perfect, the most eloquent. He's looking for those who actually believe him. That's who he's going to use to change the world.
Right here at the church at 7 p.m. if you can come out for Bible study. This is OSL.
Give me an hour, and I will give you a whole new life.
Mm-hmm.
life so that you can change the world. If you get your bulletin, you have the next five levels. You have all the dates. We are moving level one from today because the people who want to take level one seem to be the people who are right now involved in membership class. So we're going to move it to February 9th. Get past the Super Bowl and those things that people get distracted by. Level 1 will start February 9th through March 8th. That's 5:30 to 8 p.m. Level 2, 3, 4, and 5 are 5 to 8 p.m. Level 1 is 5 Sundays. Levels 2, 3, 4, and 5 are 7 Sundays. Level 2 will start March 15th. Level 3 will start February 23rd. Level 4 will start April 5th. And Level 5 will start February 9th. With level one. So if you are interested, you must have had the levels before to take the next level. And I can always tell you, I'm not going to go into detail what each one does right now. I will say level one is all about the love that God has for you. Well, I'll go real quick. Level one, all about the love God has for you. Level two, the covenant that you stand in with Jesus, the blood covenant. Level three is all about the Bible, how it came to be, how we know it's inerrant, how we know that it's the Word of God, how it was protected through the ages. It's a semester of Bible college on steroids. Level four is using your spiritual giftings, your spiritual weapons, and level five is about ministry in the local church. So sign up for those. Level one runs four times a year. The other levels all run twice a year. Please get on board with those things, and there's new forms in the back you can fill out. Tells you how much each class is and those types of things. We don't make any money on it. It's all about the curriculum that we give you and the DVDs and the CDs and those types of things. Amen? So please take part of Operation Solid Lives this year. Calendars are out. If you didn't pick up a calendar last week, your annual calendars are out. They're ready to go. You can see Teresa at the office. We want to make sure every family gets one, and so please pick that up. If you have your old calendars, would like to bring them back, we can reuse them because believe it or not, those things do get expensive if we keep buying material over and over again for them. So keep that in mind. This Wednesday, 6 p.m., community supper, 7 p.m., Bible study. We are looking at, it's online. I should have known that, and I don't have the title, but Bible study is 1 Corinthians. It's the second message in 1 Corinthians. Get a hold of that. Awana is Zoom night. Anything needs to be said about that, Mrs. Kim? Okay, and then in youth group, we're finishing up our series on the good life. Saturday, 10 a.m. is music team practice. Anything you need to say about that, honey? That is on the calendar. Music team, singers, whatever. You'll see four dates on the calendar, correct, every quarter for practice, so we can do new songs and things like that. Anything need to be said? Oh, short practice. Okay. And then Sunday, next Sunday, 6 p.m. membership class. Tonight's membership class as well. Tonight's membership class will be all about Foursquare as a group, as our authority. So we'll look at the government that we have. We'll look at the policy. We'll look at what we believe, why we believe what we believe, and those types of things. So if you don't want to be, if you're not coming in the membership, but you'd like to sit under that and refresh on that or get to know that, 6 o'clock tonight, we'll have you out by 7. New members coming in. Let me say this. I'm excited. We've got about 8 new members coming in. Really excited about that, but know this. Don't come into membership if you're not going to be here. In 3 weeks, we have the most hardest meeting to have every year. It's our annual business meeting. And now that we're adding 8 new members, that raises our quorum higher. We need to have a quorum to make that meeting work. And so if you're coming in as membership, but you're not going to be here and you're not going to attend the annual business meetings, do us a favor and don't come into membership. I don't mean to sound cruel. It's just we need a quorum. We need 50% or more to be able to hold that meeting. And the higher our membership goes and the less people who come, it makes it very hard to achieve that quorum, and it makes it very hard to do the business of the church. So I have to say that in love. I want you as members, but know that you are coming in to do something. And one of the things we're asking that you're going to do is be a part of the annual business meeting. It's the 29th, Wednesday night, from 7 to 8 p.m. We go over every penny that came in, every penny that went out, let you know all the things that are happening in the church for the year and those types of things. So please keep that in mind. Is that okay that I say that? All right. And please, because that quorum is very important. We need to have 51% here to be able to have that quorum to have. We have a list. We put people in on inactive if they've not been here in a while, and then after inactive, which we don't do a lot, we can send letters to saying at such and such council meeting, your membership is going to be taken, done away with. You can show up to the council meeting, tell us why we shouldn't do that, or whatever you want to do. They can. There will be a proxy vote. Yes, so we'll have that. And proxy vote does count as you being here, but that is for work and those types of related things, not just because, hey, I don't want to go, I'm going to send proxy. So, okay. So please. Oh, and Miss Kimmy said we're going to clean up afterwards. What's it going to take, 15 minutes? We'll just put everything Christmas. So if you can help us, if you can stay afterward, that'd be a great thing. We're going to clean up all from all the Christmas stuff. And praise God. Let's get into the word today. Amen. Turn with me over to Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22. Dave, I feel like I'm tinty. I don't know if that's coming back there. It might just be the echo I'm getting. So don't change it if you're fine with how I sound. I just sound tinny to me. So I'm not asking you to change anything. I just wanted you to be aware of what I'm hearing so that you, I know you're on the ball, brother. I love sound men. I know they're hard to get, so I don't ever want to bite one. So as long as I'm heard, I'm a happy camper. Amen. Praise God. Let's pray. Father, it is a privilege to speak your word, God. I pray that I would never take it for granted. I pray that I would never just cruise through it. I pray that I would never just be on automatic, but that I would always be guided by your Holy Spirit. I ask, God, as we come to this most serious part of what we're doing right now, that you get to speak to us, that we will hear your voice, many of us in different ways. The word will be the same going out to every heart, but it will be received differently because we're at different stages of our walk with you. We're in different situations and circumstances. And today, you have called us together to speak to us. You have called us together to help us, to grow us and to mature us and to make us more like you. And so I pray for your anointing, Holy Spirit, to be upon the word. I pray that you would hide me behind the cross. I pray that it would not be myself that's seen or heard, but it would be your voice to us today, your word to us today, that it would come forth with all of its anointing and all of its power. It would bring change. It would bring growth. It would bring all the things that you want to bring. And so God, just this is, we carve it out. We put aside the distractions. We put aside the things that are calling at us even now, God, and say, Lord, speak to me. I want to hear. I need to hear what you have today. Let your word just be truth today. Let it be solid today. Let it be on fire today, God, and let it make a difference in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So this morning we get to start our theme for the year, and I'm excited about it. The theme for the year 2020 is Come to the Table. And what I'm believing as I'm studying for this and as I've been thinking about this since October and as I believe the Lord's dropped it into my heart is that this is an invitation from our Lord Jesus to join him in the many things that he's doing. And so he says, come to the table. I just have a sense that there's just going to be a lot of things that we go into with this. And I think it's just going to be, I think one of the greatest themes that we've had, not that any of the others have been inferior by any means, but it just seems to me that this is an activation stage for us and that God is calling us. And so you think about the table, Jesus inviting us to the table, Jesus calling us as his church, as his people to the table. Because think about it, there are great times around tables, aren't there? In restaurants, I have a great time with men over at Dunkin' Donuts. We have a great time when we get together with one another. We go to homes, we go to coffee shops, we go to places, and we just have a great time together. There's something that happens around those tables. Praise God. What happens? Life is experienced around the family table. Life is experienced there. Things are talked about there. Things are discussed there. Choices and balances are weighed out around that table. I know many times with our boys as they were deciding to do things, much of that conversation would come up around the dinner table. And to families, if you don't have a dinner table, you got to make time for it. We don't have time for anything. We got the sports and we got the jobs and we got this and we got that. But I want to tell you, I think that two things that are being affected in the church as well as the community, but there's no difference in the church, inside or outside the church. Number one is marriages being attacked. Number one is just the divorce rate. It's just unbelievable. I get, it's the world we live in. But I also believe that a lot of that has to do with a lack of communication and the dinner table, the family table. The place where the family comes and sits down together, looks across the table from another, puts the phones away, puts the computers away, puts everything away. And for once, we just look at each other and talk. And discuss life and discuss choices and discuss where this family's headed and what this family's doing. And I can't tell you enough how important I believe that the family table is. Choices and balances are weighed out there. Our boys made some choices about life around our dinner table. Now, especially in the Middle Eastern culture. And this is a Middle Eastern book. How many know that? And that's why OSL Level 2, if you've taken one and not taken two, you've got to hear Blood Covenant from a Middle Eastern perspective.
because that's the only way we understand it. It's not the blood covenant that we talk about in America. You know, you cut your finger and you put your fingers together. And no, this was serious. Somebody died in this. Something was given up for this, and something was maintained in this. And that's the covenant that we have with Jesus. And so this Middle Eastern culture, the table is very important. When that family, when that tribe, when whatever comes around that table, it is very important. Things are decided. Life and death issues are decided. Pacts are made, and friendships are made, and enemies are talked about, and things like that. The table is very important. Might that be why, as I've already said, it's so greatly attacked and disappearing in our Western culture? This theme, I believe, is going to take us to a lot of different scriptures through the year. And I think it's going to give us a much greater understanding of what Jesus is calling each and every one of us to, and what it means to be involved around the table or involved in the things of the kingdom of God. And so that's what I'm believing. That's what God keeps dropping into my heart. Our scriptures that I believe the Lord has given me for this year is Luke 22, verses 14 and 15. We'll get there in just a second. But what I want to do is look at them from a little bigger scope today. I think we're going to spend a lot of time in Luke 22. It seems to be that's where God's leading me. But I want to look at just a little bigger scope than just 14 and 15 this morning as we set the stage for this. So let's go to Luke 22, verse 14, and we're going to read down to verse 20. This is Jesus instituting the Lord's Supper, the communion table. When the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. Listen to what Jesus says in verse 15. Then he said to them, "With fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you." Jesus is getting ready to lay down his life for his friends. As a matter of fact, in just a few hours after this, he will be seized in the Garden of Gethsemane. He will be taken, he'll be mocked, he will be beaten, and we know that he will be crucified. He's laying down his life for his friends. He's laying down his life for us. He's laying down his life for the world. He knows what he is about to face. Jesus does not go into this lighthearted. Jesus does not go into this not knowing what is about to happen. He knows what he's about to do. And he's had the disciples set up a place for the Passover meal. Now you would think, I understand being Jewish, I understand that this is a meal that they had to take, but you would think with what he was going through that he might think about getting away from everybody for a while and spending time with just the Father. But that's not what he does. He says, find this place, there's an upper room, it's been prepared, set up for the Passover meal, and the disciples go and do so. And now he's gathered around that Passover meal table with them. And look at verses in 14 and 15 again. When the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him, and then he said to them, "With fervent desire, with great desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." We see that in the midst of his worst moment in his human life, what does Jesus want to do? He wants to sit down and eat with his friends. He wants to share the Passover meal with them. He wants to celebrate what Father God had done in Israel with them. In fact, he says that it is with fervent desire that I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. In other words, this was great need for me. This was something that I could not give up. This is something that I want to do, something that I desire to do. If you know the word desire, it has a lot of meaning to it. It's something that our hearts are set on. It's something that we won't give up on. Desire can lead us astray from God, right? Desire can lead us to God. It all depends on what those desires are, how the mind is working, and how the heart is involved in those things. And Jesus says, it is my desire to eat this with you, to call you to this table before I suffer. And I think, church, that we miss something many times that Jesus had said about us but which this scene brings out so powerfully. It's my first point today. I think that we miss that we are friends with Christ. I think that is so powerful when we really get the meaning of that. And I think we just go through life and we sing the song, I am a friend of God. What does it mean that you're a friend of God? It means that He calls you. It means that He lets you into His life. It means that He calls you one like Him. It means, oh my gosh, we got to get a hold of that. We have to live life like we're really friends with Christ. We don't get it. We miss out on it. John 15:15. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all things that I heard from my Father, I have made known to you. And so Jesus invites us to his table, listen, because we are his friends. There's nothing like sitting around a table with friends. Anybody found that to be true? Right? Family, you can call family, whatever. But there's nothing like sitting around the table with friends. This statement marks such a huge difference between the Old and the New Testaments. In the Old Testament, David is a servant of the living God. In the Old Testament, Daniel is a servant of the living God. In the Old Testament, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are servants of God. In the Old Testament, Moses is my servant. In the Old Testament, and we could go through each and every name, they are my servant. Esther was his servant, his handmaid. Servants do not eat at the table. Do you get that? Servants aren't invited to partake of the meal. Servants, it's like, you know, growing up, you knew you made it at Thanksgiving when you finally got to leave the children's table, right? And you got to sit with the adults, or at least move up maybe to the teenage table. And we used to have so many people in our house that tables were all over the place. Servants don't eat at the table. But in the New Testament, what does he say? You are no longer servants, but you are my friends. And he invites them to the table. Listen, church, get this today. Pray, Lord, seal it in our hearts. Make us think about it this week. Do something to bring this alive in our lives. We are invited to the table as friends. Friends of God. Friends with Christ. I looked up the word friend. We all know what it means, but I looked it up. A friend is one who is loved. It's a beloved. It's one who is dear. I love this one. It's one who is another self. In other words, many of my friends are going to be people who think like I think, who are in life like I live, who do the same things I do. Why? Because they're like myself. I want to be with like-minded people. I want to be with people like myself. And so a friend is one like yourself. Now, it doesn't mean we can't have opposing point of views. I think there's a great asset to a friendship who sees things a little different, because then they get me thinking about things that normally I wouldn't think of because, well, my mind is just bent this way. Make sense? And so he calls us friends, a dear one, as in a family member, or the nearest and dearest. So if we're looking at Jesus calling his friends to the table, then let me tell you this, the table is a place where love is expressed. Amen? I don't see Georgia today, but her mother, is she here? Well, usually you sit way back there. What are you doing up front? You're really shocking me. But if you knew the Beamer clan, man, well, Ruth too. You know, I mean, dinner time at that house was, wow. And Mrs. Beamer, I don't know how she fed all those kids. Because it wasn't just her kids. It was all their friends. I mean, it was a picnic table bench that I remember in the dining room. And people were just all around it. She never worried whether she had enough or didn't have enough. She just put out and everybody just came and ate. And you had kids you didn't even know. Where'd he come from? But it was fun. Why did we hang out at the Beamer house? Because it was fun. It was never boring. Right? Because you had kids all every different age. You had male, female. You had, my gosh, it was just a conglomerate of children and teenagers and just, wow, it was a great place to be. The table is a place where love is expressed. Jesus invites us to his table today to express his love towards us. Listen to me. Somebody needs to get this today. Jesus has invited you to his table today to express his love toward you. And I don't know who this is for. This is not in my notes. But I feel under the unction of the Holy Spirit to say, you have been going through life. You might even be a believer, you may not be, but you're sitting here today and you never knew the love that Jesus had for you. But today something is breaking in your heart. I can't even express what's happening, but God is at work in your life as the Holy Spirit. And something new is coming into your thinking today because of just these few words that I'm saying, God's love is starting to sink in. God's love is going to make a difference. He invites you to his table because he doesn't want anything from you. He just wants to tell you how much he loves you. Sit at my table today because I love you. Sit at my table today because I want to be with you. Sit at my table today because there's things that I have for you. It would seem that Jesus was comforted by this meal around this table, doesn't it? He's about to give his life. He's about to be arrested. He's about to be killed. He's about to be mocked, spit on, beat almost to death. What did he need? He needed his friends. He needed time with them. He needed time to spend with them. He needed to make sure not only that he was okay, but he needed to make sure that they were okay. Listen, this is the heart of God. God calls us to the table today to make sure we're okay. He knows what you've been through. He knows what you've experienced. He knows what's going on. And some of us have even stayed away from the table because we don't want to reveal ourselves to him. He knows it. And he says, come to the table because I want to make sure you're going to be okay. And apparently, he also received something from their company in this situation. He wanted to see their faces again before he suffered, because the next time he sees their faces, he's going to look into the face of Peter, who just denied him. He's going to look into the face of Judas, who's about ready to hang himself. He's going to look into the face of Peter and John at the cross as he's bleeding out. And the faces that he sees in those situations are not the faces that he wants to see now at the table. Do you get it? And so he just wants to look at their faces before he suffers. He wanted to hear their voices again. He wants to hear their laughter. He wants to hear their conversation. Even though they didn't get it all, even though some of them were a little confused about what was about to happen, he just wanted that time. And I guarantee you there was laughter around that dinner table. I guarantee you there were jokes being told, or things that, you know, just because, hey, you know, Peter, hey, yeah, you put your foot in your mouth again, Peter. Hey, yeah, you're good at that. You know, I don't know. I don't think they picked on each other or wore one another down. They could tell his heavy spirit, but Jesus just wanted that. How many times do we just want? You know, the greatest desire, our fervent desire, is to eat dinner with our children now. Doesn't happen enough. It happens at holidays now, if it can happen. And so our greatest joy this year at Christmas time was leaving so early in the morning, 3:30 in the morning, headed to the airport. Why? We could be at breakfast with Kenny and Megan in North Carolina. Have Christmas breakfast. And then we took another 6:30 flight home on Friday. Why? Because we wanted to eat breakfast with Chris. Christmas breakfast. I'm like, man, we should have a few more kids. I could have had like 5 Christmas breakfasts. That's a sweet deal, man. I love Christmas breakfast. There was a special comfort when we're among friends. And this is what Jesus was feeling. Why? Because our friends care for us. If they don't care for us, why would we call them friends? They care for us. Our friends are concerned about us. And our friends, come on, our friends know how to reach us in our pain and stress. I had a really great joy this week because I'm wondering where I really stand with my buddy Tony. You know, we've been out of reach for 29 years. We just reconnect. And I'm just wondering, he doesn't do any texting. He hardly ever answers his phone, so I leave messages. He never gets back to me. But, you know, this week I'm here Wednesday night, and I'm getting ready for youth. I'm getting ready for the Bible study, and in comes this voice. I hear, hey, Kenny, you in here? And there's Tony. And he just shows up here. He sought me out. You know what that felt like? It felt like gold. You know, it felt like he really does care. And then I go home the next day and we find this little letter, just a little note. Hey, Tony was here again. You know, he's always trying to find us. And Tony was here again. And love you, Ken. Love you, Kim. Makes a difference. And so this is what Jesus was looking for. They care for us. They're concerned about us. They know how to reach us in our pain. They know how to reach us in our stress. And you know what else Jesus wanted to do? He wanted to say goodbye to them. He was a friend who sticks closer than a brother. He didn't want to be picked up without being able to say goodbye. Yes, he would see them again. Yes, he would spend time with them again, but he would never spend time with them again like he had in the last 3 years. Things were forever going to change that evening. Look what he says again here in verse 15. With fervent desire, I have waited for this moment around this table with you, because I will not do this again until we are all in another place in heaven around Father's throne. That's what he says. Now, he did eat with them after he rose from the dead. It says that he ate, so we know he wasn't a spirit, right? The Bible's very clear on that. He wasn't a ghost. He ate. He took in food. But it was never the same. Because now he's the Lord. Now he's the Savior. He's one step further than he was when he walked with them and talked with them and shared with them and slept with them in the same rooms and things like that on the beach and wherever, in a boat or wherever he was at. It was different. When we travel, the last thing that I do before I shut my phone off in the airplane is I text my boys or I call them. Why? Because I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know if I'm ever going to see them again. And so I just want to. It's not a morbid thought. It's a thought of, I just want to make sure there's no loose strings. I just want to make sure that I've told Kenny and Chris, I love you guys. I'm going to miss you, and I can't wait to see you again. When we go on a cruise, the last thing, because I don't use my phone, I don't want to be connected on a cruise. I don't want to know what's happening in our world on a cruise. My phone goes in the safe, so as we're pulling out at dinner time, the last thing I do, hey guys, we're getting ready to pull out. Oh yeah, we're not going to be able to reach you. Ari, nope, you ain't reaching me for nothing, man. I'm on the deck reading a book all day. I just want to say goodbye. I just want to say I love you. If we hit an iceberg, just know everything's good, and we're going to be great, all right? If it's just me traveling, I call my wife. Honey, I love you. It's not like, honey, if I never see you, it's nothing like that. It's just in my heart, I know it's settled. I've said what I needed to say, and it's good, right? I hope I get to say more, but if not, it's good. If something happens that brings about a change, I want to make sure that I've said what I've said, that I needed to do what I needed to do, so that everybody's taken care of. This is what this table was about on this evening. This is what Jesus had called his friends for. Listen, as friends with Christ, we share things in common with him. You got to have something in common with your friends, or they're not friends. There are conversations that we can have around the table that we cannot have with others. Does that make sense? And if that doesn't make sense, let me bring to you the way Jesus taught. Jesus taught using what? Parables. Stories that related to farming. Stories that related to the local land. Stories that people could say, oh, I know that. I've been to that place. Oh, I did that today. Oh my gosh, yeah, that relates to me. And he told these parables. But what did he tell his disciples? Very few get them. They didn't even get them sometimes. They had to come and say, Jesus, tell us what this parable's about. He says, very few get them. So it's not for everybody, but it is for my friends. As my friends, you should know what I'm saying. As my friends, you should understand where I'm at. As my friends, the message should be very clear, because not only do you know me, you know my heart, you know my thinking process, you know everything about me. What's he say? He who has ears to hear, let him hear. And then he says, my sheep know my voice. Amen? Secondly, coming to the table means we are partakers in Christ. So we are friends of Christ, we are partakers in Christ. Isn't it amazing that at the table that Jesus greatly desired to be at with his disciples, it wasn't just the table of death, for to them it took on a new meaning. Yes, it was a table of celebration. What was Passover? Passover was the celebration for the Israelites that back in Egypt, when they put the blood of the lamb upon the lentil, that the death angel passed over them. None of their firstborn were killed. So it was a celebration. It was a remembrance of what God had done. But now it becomes even a greater remembrance. It becomes the table of remembrance. And Jesus says, here's my bread. Or here's the bread. This is my body. Here's the cup. This is my blood. Now do this in remembrance of me. Hallelujah. Going back to my statement earlier that I said that this was going to change forever for these men, and Jesus says, I will not eat of this again until we are in the kingdom together. Jesus now institutes a new table. But, so I'm never going to eat again this table until you're in heaven with me, but here's a table that you have for one another. Here's a table that you can invite your friends to. Here's a table that will make a difference in your life. Here's the table of communion. Do this in remembrance of me. Communion is something that only friends can do. I can only commune with friends. I can only commune with family. I can only commune with my brothers and sisters in the church. I can only, because I only have that in common with them. You know, not everybody can just run to a commune or to a community and say, "Hey, I want to be a part." They're going to look at you and say, "Why? You don't understand the life we live. You don't understand what it means to take a vow of poverty or to do this or to do that. So why would you want to be a part of us?" No, there's another plan here that you have. And you know what? We're not going to let you be a part of this because it's wrong. Because our people have committed to one another. Our people have taken vows of poverty with one another. Our people have committed to the life of the commune, of the community, rather than to life in the world. We have committed to this thing that's going to keep us going further and further and growing and maturing and becoming more like Christ. So why would we let you in? And Jesus invites, listen, us to the table of community. Jesus invites us, as often as we would like, to remind us that we have a part in Him. This group of disciples didn't get it yet, but they would after His death and resurrection. My question is, do we get it today? Do we understand what it means that I have a part in Christ? Do we understand what it means that I live in Christ? To answer that question, I need to ask another question. Are you just living for Christ, or are you living in Christ? Because there's a big difference. And it's a difference that makes a difference in who you are as a believer, and who you are as a Christian, and who you are as a follower. Living for something is trying to achieve something. Isn't that right? I'm living, I'm working to buy a house. I'm living, I'm working to buy a car. I'm living, I'm doing this so that I can be in relationship with this person. And so I'm living for something, it's achieving something, but living in something is already having achieved it, amen. I live in a house, I don't live for a house. It's a small house, but I live in a house. I live in a relationship with a woman whom I'm very honored to be in relationship with. I was trying to look for a word, and I couldn't. Honored and loving and you know, but sometimes I stumble in those things. And yet in the church today, there are so many Christians trying to attain Christ, trying and struggling to be good, trying and struggling to say all the right things, trying and struggling to be like Him, or attaining to some sort of level of spirituality that some denomination or some book that they've read places over them, and they're stumbling and they're failing and they're falling apart and they're wondering what's going on here. But here's the deal, church. It's already done. It's already accomplished. Jesus did it. Amen? He completed it. We don't have to attain to be like Christ. We just need to allow Him to live in us and live through us. And guess what happens? We become Christ. Amen? The church should be like Christ, not become like Christ. We should be Christ because He's in our midst today. He's the overpastor, the overshepherd of this church. And so we become Him. We live in Him. And this is why He takes the bread, and this is why He takes the cup, and He says, "This is me." It wasn't that it changed over. It wasn't that it became that. It was as we take of it, He wanted us to remind ourselves, I am in Christ. I am a partaker of Christ. I'm involved in this thing. I'm committed to this thing. I'm living in this thing. Every time. And we're going to go to the communion table in closing today. Every time we take of the communion table, we're making a statement. Here's the statement that we make. And you could add or subtract from it, but here's the statement that I believe we're making. This is what Christ did for us. And as I eat and drink these elements, I am joining myself to this man, to this Savior's sacrifice, but also to His resurrection and to His victory. I am partaking of Him so that I can live in Him, and because He lives in me, I can assuredly say that this is who I am and this is what I expect out of my life as a Christian. That's what that little piece of bread means. That's what that cup means. We are partakers in Him. We are one with Him. And because of that, He invites us to the table to talk and to plan and to strategize the business of the kingdom. This Thursday night, I got to attend my first board meeting with Brother Adam's community with their business. They invited me to be on the board. I know what they do. I know how they do it. I mean, I've done some things with him and seen them working and things like that. But for the first time, now I'm invested in it. See what I'm saying? Because now I'm a board member. Now I have a voice. They've invited me to the table. And so now I get to attend that. And I become, and I get to hear the business of the business. And I'm invited to discuss its ins and its outs. I'm invited to discuss its successes and its struggles. And they ask me to give input as a pastor in the community. It's a great honor. Whenever we're invited to something, I wonder how many actually see, because I think our church business meeting, and this isn't a commercial, I just thought of this. I wonder how many would actually attend our church business meeting if they actually understand, wait a minute, that's who I am. I'm part of that gathering. I should celebrate with that gathering what Christ has done. I should be there to hear the reports. I know they're boring. I get it. You know, it might be better to have a toe removed than to sit in a business meeting. I get that. But isn't it important that we belong to something? Isn't it important that we're part of something that makes a difference and we get to celebrate? Vision casting takes place around the table. Jesus is casting vision. There's plans for success. There's plans for victory. They're drawn up there. My uncle Rob, I have two uncles that are into medical machines and things like that. They've done very well. My uncle Rob, I think it was my uncle Rob. I want to say it was my uncle Rob. If not, it was one of my other uncles. My dad had four other brothers. My Uncle Rob met the fellow who built the Kinex. You know the Kinex? The big, they have a big Ferris wheel. I mean, if you ever bought them for your kids, they're like thousands and thousands of dollars. I mean, hundreds of dollars. Yeah, and you've seen them. I mean, the Ferris wheel my brother had was had to be this big. And, you know, and they got little motors and they're little things that connect to gears and things like that. And so, it, you know, it's like Legos. I don't understand why plastic Legos cost an arm and a leg. They're plastic. But they do. And so Kinex are very expensive. My uncle Rob, I believe it was, met the man who created Kinex. They were doing something and he happened to be there. Do you know where Kinex was invented? In an airport. He had missed his flight. He was waiting for another flight at the end of the day. He was in a restaurant. He was bored out of his skull. And so he took things on the restaurant table, straws and other things, and he began to put them together and build little things on the table. And out of straws and napkins and other things that connect on an airport table came this system of hundreds of dollars that parents spend to give to their kids a little joy as they create things and build things. What happens? Things happen on tables. Things are drawn up around tables. In talking about vision casting around the table, turn with me over to Luke chapter 14, just a few scriptures back, a few chapters back, and look at verse 25. Jesus teaches about this, and then he invites his disciples to the table to talk about it. Luke chapter 14, verse 25. Now great multitudes went with him, and he turned and said to them, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple." Let me make this clear, because this is probably one of the most misunderstood scriptures in the Bible. Jesus isn't saying hate mom and dad, hate brothers and sisters. Jesus is saying, if they take precedence over me, you are not my disciple. He's saying, if you're going to follow me, if you're going to commit your life to me, then mom, dad, brothers, sisters, friends, all of this other stuff has to come secondary to me. I have to be first. That's what he's saying. And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not sit down first and count the cost? Doesn't come to the table, right? Whether he has enough to finish it. Lest after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, "This man began to build and was not able to finish." Or what king going to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks conditions of peace. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if the salt has lost its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land nor for the dunghill, but men throw it out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. This is table talk for Jesus, right? This is table talk. This is planning at its best. This is what Jesus does. He invites his disciples. And I want you to look at something. I want you to keep in mind the story about the king. What king goes to war against another king and does not sit down first at the table and decide whether he's got enough to do it or not? And this brings me to my third point. We are committed to Christ. I put it up there on purpose like that. The question that Jesus needed to see at the table with his friends before he was about to give his life was, were they really committed to him? Were they really sold out to him? What he wanted to know as he looked in Peter's eyes, what he wanted to know as he looked at Judas and dipped the bread with him, what he wanted to know as he looked at John and Andrew and all of the others, what he wanted to know was, hey, when things go crazy in the next few hours, are they going to be the ones I can count on? Are they going to be the ones to take this the next step? Look at the topics that are dealt with around this table. We're going to go into it in the next few weeks. One of the topics is who would betray him? These are friends. One of the topics was who would deny him? One of the topics was who would be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? What's Jesus really doing here? I'll tell you what he's doing here. He's dealing with their failures around the table of love so that they had a chance to succeed when everything broke down. Thank God for that. The king going to war, sitting at the table and deciding, do I have enough to make it work? I think Jesus may have been speaking about himself. For at this moment, at the table of Passover, in the upper room, with 12 men gathered around him, Jesus is the king that is going to war. He is about to go to the cross and pay the greatest price to defeat the kingdom of hell. And this king is sitting around the table with the ones that he has to trust in to lead this thing forward, looking into their eyes, knowing their failures, wondering, do they have what it takes? Because I'm about to put it in their hands. This battle will belong to them. Do I have the warriors that I need to make it happen? Will this thing succeed if I count on them? Because after all, this is a battle with eternity in the balance. And Jesus looks at his friends and sees their failures. Peter, tonight you're going to deny me three times. John and Andrew, forget about who's the greatest in heaven. It's the children that are the greatest in heaven. I'm sitting at the right hand of the Father. Get over it. Deal with it. Because you're going to have to go out and take this word forth. I need to know that you guys are ready. Judas, I'm sorry. Satan has long sifted you, and I've had to turn you over to him. I can't count on you. I'm sure that hurt Jesus, but you're not going to be one of the ones they're going to lead this. You're not even going to be around after a day. Think about this. Jesus invites us, friends, family, to the church, to the table today. Because he knows your failures. He knows your weaknesses. He knows what will trip you up. He knows what's going to make you fall. But he wants you to succeed. And so he calls you to the table. And yes, it hurts sometimes. He's going to point those things out. But praise God, the end result is greater than the first. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward. I'm not finished the message yet. But this would be a great place to serve communion. I just need 8 people. If you're not on the usher, just come forward. I need 8 people. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 3 more. 6, 7, 8. Good. We got them all. I wasn't having communion today, and as I was going over the notes this morning and doing things, the Lord said, pull out the communion today. Today's the day. And I thought, well, gee, we were supposed to do that last week. Yeah, don't worry. You didn't forget. I got all this planned. Thanks, Lord. Amen. And then I found gold communion plates. Where do we get those from? I mean, they're not gold. Don't steal them. They're fake. But I never knew we had them. Rick, if you'll just give the 4 center ones the bread. Hold the elements as they come out. Let me say this first. We don't believe in this church that there's any hoop you need to jump through to take communion. Jesus invites us all to the table. I do believe that we have to have our hearts right with him. And so if you're not in the right place with him, just begin to pray today and begin to set your heart in order. Maybe you need to confess something to him today. Do that. But make this a place today where we can all together come to the table, where nobody's out, but everybody's in. Amen. And let's hold the elements. We'll take them all together. Go ahead and serve these folks. Thank you. Dave, thank you for the music. I appreciate that. We're not finished the message yet, so stay zoned in. You're taking communion today because you're a friend of Christ. Think about that. Think about the fact that you are a friend of the Creator of the universe. David did in the Psalms when he said, "Who am I that you would be mindful of me?" So you're invited to the table today because you're his friend. You're invited to the table today because you are a partaker in him, of him. These elements represent his broken body. These elements represent the blood that was shed for us. And I pray that you'll take the table today and come to the table because there is a commitment to him. It'll cost you everything. I'm not going to lie to you. It'll cost you everything. But what comes out in the end is greater than any cost that any of us will ever pay to serve Jesus Christ. Just be mindful of those things. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Maybe you need to hear him call your name, say, "Come to the table." Let him call you today. Let his love shine upon you. Joining us online today, maybe you could just go to your refrigerator. If you have grape juice, fine. If not, pull out a little bit of Coke, pull out milk. It's not the element that means anything. If you don't have a cracker, pull out, I don't know, a piece of Slim Jim. It doesn't matter. It's not about the element. It's about what it means. But take communion with us today online, because I believe that God is going to do something in our lives today as he's invited us to the table. And so go ahead and do that quickly. And then come back to where you're at so that you can join us in this today. Let me go back to my last thought as we end this with communion today. The King of Kings is going to war. He sits down at the table because he needs to know, is this going to succeed? Because his plan is not to make peace with the enemy. His plan is to destroy the kingdom of hell. And he's given everything. He's committed everything to it. But he just needs to know, will they be there? Will they survive the chaos of the next 3 days? Will they come through? Will they shine brightly? Will, you know, when the Holy Spirit comes upon them, will they walk in that and know that? And so I ask you today, where's your commitment to Christ today, brothers and sisters, as we hold these elements? Because the table will show you. The time at the table will speak volumes to where you are in your commitment to Christ. Jesus knows the battle you're facing. You're no different than Peter. You're no different than any of the other disciples that were dealing with things, who will be the greatest in heaven. And he isn't going to hold back at the table, because he needs you in a place, because he knows what's about to happen. He wants you to be honest about your shortcomings so that you can see victory in those areas. Stop holding on to them. Stop saying, well, I'm just a failure, so I'm always going to be that. No, Jesus says, no, this table changes things. This table makes a difference. And so he calls you to the table this morning to say, listen, this is going to affect you. What are you going to do about it? He calls you to the table today to tell you this is limiting your ability to defeat the enemy in your life. When are you going to take care of it? He calls you to the table today to say this is causing defeat in your life. When will you finally get tired of it and allow me to work you through it? How are you going to react to those things at this table today? This is what made the communion table such a special place for the disciples. Because at this point, it's just imagery. Jesus is still with them. Hey, this is my bread. Or this bread is my body. Hey, this cup is my blood that will be poured out for you. They didn't get it yet. Oh, wow, that's deep maybe. You know, I don't know. You know, and they're looking at it in light of the Passover cups and the Passover meal. And so they're getting some imagery, but they're not getting the whole thing. But after his death and after his resurrection, something changes. And we know that the church goes from house to house, eating and drinking. And that eating and drinking is taking of the communion meal, coming to the table that the Lord had set for them. See, after his death and resurrection, it becomes powerful. After his death and resurrection, Peter, who denied him, has hope again. Peter, do you love me? Yeah, I love you. Peter, do you love me? Jesus, I love you. Peter, do you love me? Will you commit everything to me? Jesus, you know I love you. Then go feed my sheep. You couldn't even stand up for me. But I'm sending you to feed the church. I'm sending you to plant churches. I'm sending you to lead them and guide them. This is your victory, church. This is your victory. This is what it represents. This is your power. This is your ability to overcome, not these things, but what they represent. Do this in remembrance of me. I want to ask this because I'd be amiss if not doing this. Is there anyone here today, just bow your heads, close your eyes. Is there anyone here today before we take communion that would say, Pastor Kent, I don't know Jesus the way you're preaching him today, but there's something in my heart that says I need to take that next step, and I'm here to do it. I want to pray with you before we take communion today. Is there anybody, by raising your hand, would say, Pastor Kent, would you pray with me today? I need that in my life. Anybody? Amen. Glory. Praise God. Then as believers, we come to the table. Jesus took the bread. He blessed it. He broke it. He broke it on purpose because he wanted them to have a picture of what they would see in a day and a half. His body broken. To the point the Bible says that you couldn't even tell it was a man. And he says, go into war. I want to make you successful. I want to make you the warriors that I need. I'm giving my life for you. Jesus, thank you for the broken body. Thank you for the bread. Thank you for what you did for us so that we don't have to be who we were, but we can be who you say we are. Jesus, I ask that everything that this table means would come to fruition in our lives, that there'd be an impartation of your presence and of your spirit as we partake of this today. That we would hear you calling us your friend. That we would hear you saying, be a partaker in me and of me. That we would be, that there would be a greater commitment in our lives toward you and toward the kingdom of heaven. Seal this in our lives today. Amen. Let's partake of the bread. Jesus, we come to the cup. that you would face what you faced, physically, spiritually, emotionally, so that we could be free and healed physically, spiritually, and emotionally. I pray that as we get ready to drink this today, that there would be an impartation of your healing power. I pray today that as we drink this today, there would be an impartation of your love and your acceptance of us, no matter where we've been, no matter what road we've walked in life. I pray that as we drink this today, there would be an impartation of your power and of your presence, that men and women would go free in this place today from the things that the enemy has used to keep them down and under. I pray, O God, that as we drink, there'd be a life and a newness and a refreshing of our spiritual walk today, sealed by the pouring of your blood over our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's partake today. Just begin to praise Him. If you have a spiritual tongue, begin to praise Him. If you just English, praise Him. Spanish, praise Him. Filipino, praise Him. Just praise Him today. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You've invited us to the table. You've called us to be one with you. Lord, help us. Help us in our failures. Help us in our misgivings. Help us in our misunderstandings. Help us in our tragedies and our hurts. Help us in our, oh God, just help us. We believe that this table changes things. And this week we're going to live in it and expect it. Thank you, Lord. Lord, dismiss us in your love and in your care today. Watch over us and keep us. We trust in you. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you for this word. Let it resound in our hearts this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. If you can help tear the place down, not the place down, but the decorations down. I'm going to see you in the back. Say hi to each and every one of you today. I'm feeling much better, so I can hug.